Hello and welcome. I'm Palki Sharma Upadhyay. You're watching The World is One, a show that brings you the tallest political minds from across the world. We have global leaders coming on this platform to share their ideas, discuss challenges, and present perspectives on issues that matter to you. On the show today, we feature a man who's credited with overthrowing the Taliban regime and starting a new chapter in Afghanistan, His Excellency Hamid Karzai. Born on December 24, 1957 in Kars, Afghanistan, Hamid Karzai was educated in Afghanistan and India before rising through the political ranks during the turbulent Soviet occupation in his country. By 2001, he'd emerged as a resistance leader under the Taliban rule. After the fall of the Taliban, Karzai's political status grew. He was selected to head the transitional administration and then a presidential government before becoming the first elected leader of Afghanistan in 2004. Re-elected in a fraud-ridden poll in 2009, Karzai remained in power for more than a decade, heading a government accused of widespread corruption and limited authority. Karzai was often derided as the mayor of Kabul, always an Indophile given his personal ties with the country and common interests against Pakistan. Karzai has backed Delhi's position on Pakistan-sponsored terror and human rights violations in Balochistan. He has called on India to play a larger role in Afghanistan's military development and take bold steps to lead the geopolitical shifts in the region.
Your Excellency, welcome to the show.
Pleased to meet you.
And welcome to India.
Thank you.
Your second home.
Very much. Almost first home too, yes.
So you've seen India change over the decades, from the time you came here to study to now.
Yes, yes. Well, in too many directions. One, India is a lot more prosperous than when I was here. Two, India is now a superpower player on world stage, which is very, very nice. Three, India has maintained its democratic traditions, which is remarkable, and it has advanced in technology and sciences. What has also changed is, unfortunately, the roads are a lot more crowded and traffic jams are there. So life has become difficult that way.
Part and parcel of a growing economy, I
yes,
believe.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed.
How do you see India-Afghan relations change under the current regime in Delhi?
Well, ma'am, India and Afghanistan are linked countries through ages. We come from the same stock, from the same civilization, and from the same extension of history. Therefore, ours is a different relationship. The bonds are much deeper than you look at the surface of things. Therefore, it's a fundamentally different relationship as between Afghanistan and other countries in all aspects of it. In the modern times, since the creation of nation states and all that and borders, then too, the movement of people continued between the two countries. In the very present circumstances, India is Afghanistan's greatest ally and friend and supporter. In 2002, when the new dispensation emerged in Afghanistan, when the new order came to Afghanistan with the help of the international community, India stood at the forefront of giving a helping hand to Afghanistan in raising it in all walks of life. Especially, India went beyond its way. India was not a donor country traditionally. It had its own massive needs within India and in the Indian population. But India went beyond its way to contribute almost $3 billion to Afghanistan. It gave us thousands of scholarships. As a result, we have thousands and thousands and thousands of educated boys and girls in Afghanistan who have been trained and studied in India. So thank you very much. You've done a lot. I mean, I could go on and on and on and on.
Sure, you're most welcome. You also strongly backed Prime Minister Modi's statements on Balochistan.
Oh, very much.
And do you believe it's time for the international community now to put more pressure on Pakistan to end the blatant human rights abuses there?
Absolutely. And the Prime Minister of India did the right thing. And it was in that spirit of his rightness on this issue that I immediately stood up and backed Prime Minister Modi's call for addressing the issue of the human rights of the people of Balochistan and give them the rights as a people that they seek. Therefore, yes, absolutely is the time, yes.
Among the other things that you just outlined, India has supplied Mi-25 helicopters to Afghanistan, helped train security forces there. How else can Delhi contribute to a country that's still rebuilding?
Now, it's a question of expectations. If you ask Afghans, if you asked me then and today, when I was the president today, that I'm out of office, Afghanistan would expect all to come from India in civilian assistance, in educating our population, in equipping our military force and police, in training our civilians, and in equipping and training our military forces. Also, Afghanistan would expect India to be our fundamental ally in bringing security and safety to Afghanistan, peace to Afghanistan, and in creating an environment where we together, and also with the help of the rest of the region, those who want to join us, would finally defeat extremism and terrorism in our region.
And when you say...
So it's a wholesome expectation,
sure,
as far as Afghans are concerned.
When you say a fundamental ally in bringing peace, do you mean sending people on the ground as well? Is that
not
an
necessarily
expectation?
Not necessarily. Not necessarily, and not today. The future, one never knows if the need arises. But you see why I say that? Why do many Afghans say that? For India to become a fundamental ally. We say it because the dangers to both countries are the same. The interests of both countries are the same. And the connections to the past of both countries are the same. So there are the roots of a relationship, of a strong relationship. And there is also the need of today's environment for both countries, the dangers that we face, the extremism that we face. Also, we say that because India, luckily, now is a very powerful economy, among the fastest rising economies in the world, and truly, in all spirits, a global player. So in our belief, India has the means, the capacity, and the skill to do what Afghanistan needs to be done in Afghanistan. India also shares a lot in common in terms of the vital interests of both countries to impel India, in our view, to do what we think India should be doing in Afghanistan.
Sure. So how do you respond to criticism of some that India is too diffident, that India is bereft of ideas? Some have said India is wary of taking risks when it comes to an old friend and ally like Afghanistan.
Well, India is a wise country. It isn't empty of ideas. India, as a matter of fact, is the birthplace of ideas in so many different forms, and it continues to generate ideas for within India and for the rest of the world. So I would not agree with that. But being a wise country, wisdom always brings you caution. That is something that I've also been talking with Indian leaders a lot, that India could perhaps take more visible steps with regard to what it seeks in the region and in Afghanistan. That is something I would also recommend.
That's work in progress, okay. So you've laid the foundation stone of the Afghanistan of the 21st century. There are still many, many challenges. For instance, the Taliban. How do you see the crisis vis-a-vis the Taliban in your country?
The Taliban are part of the Afghan people. Unfortunately, one of our neighbors, our brotherly country, Pakistan, in tandem with the West and some other countries, felt that using radicalism, religion, extremism, promoting extremism in that religion would serve their interests. The Americans and some Muslim allies of them did it against the Soviet Union. Pakistan used it against Afghanistan and against India. And eventually, unfortunately, within Pakistan, with immense consequences for us, the two countries of Afghanistan and India, and also now with tragic consequences for Pakistan. Therefore, this environment that has been created by the West and by Pakistan with a false hope of bringing them eventually what they seek, which will not bring them, which is being proven every day it will not bring them. So I hope that peace will come to Afghanistan, and those Taliban who are, as I said earlier, part of Afghanistan, part of our people, we want them to return to Afghanistan to a peaceful life with their own country, with their own people. And those who don't want that and who are not from Afghanistan, of course, that's a different matter.
Are the Taliban, is it a monolith now? Because there is talks, there is a lot of talk about splits, there is a lot of talk about many sections going to the Islamic State.
No, you shouldn't believe that. They're largely a monolith. They, of course, have various elements and various people, various thoughts, as in every other movement and every other political organization or group of people. But generally, they are one body, and to follow the structures of a single body.
Right. You mentioned Pakistan. The Pakistan military recently warned the new US President Donald Trump's generals that they face, and I'm quoting, a total mess in Afghanistan unless Britain and America send troops to halt the advance of the ISIS and the Taliban. Do you believe more troops will help on the ground? Is that
the need?
This
is a Pakistani general saying that?
Yes.
Well, if a Pakistani general says that the US should send more troops and more to fight the extremists in Afghanistan, then a better thing for them would be to stop training people in Pakistan and send to Afghanistan to kill us and also to kill the foreigners who are there. So I would rather suggest that rather than asking Americans to send more troops, they should close the sanctuaries, they should close the training grounds, they should close the indoctrination of young boys there into extremism, into radicalism, into committing terroristic activities. That is a better course. I don't believe that adding troops to the scene in Afghanistan would help anything. The United States was there for 15 years. Rather than, again, I'll come to my earlier emphasis, rather than waging war in Afghan villages, in Afghan homes, rather than doing things, even though unintentionally, if it may be, that would hurt the Afghan people, they better concentrate on the sanctuaries outside of Afghanistan, on the training grounds for terrorists outside of Afghanistan, on the motivational factors provided outside of Afghanistan, on the financial resources provided to extremism and terrorism and violence, the promotion of violence outside of Afghanistan. And I'm sorry to say again, I have to say, in Pakistan. I don't like to name names. I would love to refer in the best possible terms towards our brothers in Pakistan. Mm-hmm. The people are our brothers. Here, when I say Pakistan, I mean specific entities there, not the people of Pakistan.
Well, we will dwell on Pakistan in a bit, but another senior Pakistani official, army official, has been quoted as saying that Russia is expected to use the current crisis, the advance of the ISIS and the Taliban in Afghanistan as a pretext to stage a Syrian-style intervention in the region in the name of safeguarding its own backyard. Do you believe that is exaggerated?
Yes. I've had extensive dealings with Russia, another very important neighbor of Afghanistan, a very, very significant neighbor of Afghanistan. And a country who, in the form of the Soviet Union, did provide immensely to Afghanistan, but also made that immense mistake of invading Afghanistan. Russia does see today, you see, to go a bit in the past, Russia was a full backer of the US presence in Afghanistan. Russia was a full backer of the exercise against radicalism and terrorism in Afghanistan, launched by the West and supported by everybody else. But then this war became an endless war. And with each day passing, there was more extremism, not less extremism. So the Russians began to wonder, well, what is going on? What is not right in here? Is the US campaign wrong? Is the very fabric of the policy that they have wrong? And that caused suspicions, as in everybody else, as in us in Afghanistan. That was the reason I did not sign the BSA, because I didn't see clarity to the purpose there. Therefore, Russia today is legitimately concerned. I understand, and I approve of their concern. They are legitimately concerned. Daesh emerged during the presence of the United States in Afghanistan. It was under their presence, within the framework of their presence, that Daesh and the Islamic State emerged in Afghanistan. So Russia has questions. So do others. So must India. Why? To address it, of course. Russia will not resort to military action in Afghanistan. They're a wise country, but Russia has the right to seek explanations from the United States, and I hope the US will be now ready to do that in order to find a solution.
And the new dispensation in the US under President Donald Trump, what does Afghanistan expect, or how does Afghanistan see?
Well, what Afghanistan expects from President Trump, a complete review of the policy. As a citizen of Afghanistan, that's my expectation. That the United States would do a complete review of its past 15 years in Afghanistan or more. What went wrong? What was right? What did we achieve? What did we not achieve? Where we have failed, there must be a reconsideration, a redrawing of the plans, and not a repetition of the practices that brought us where we are, to this point of more extremism, more radicalism, more insecurity, and Daesh on top.
When you say a complete overhaul of policy,
yes.
In terms of policy, what we've heard from Donald Trump is only about the ISIS, and that to nothing in specifics. We want to fight the ISIS, is what he said. Beyond that, no one really knows what his policy is. No one really knows what his team looks like. There are huge vacancies. Some of the foreign policy experts we've spoken to recently said that he's perhaps not even looking at this region right now because he's so embattled at home with his own domestic issues.
Well, they have that, yes.
Believe that America is even thinking about this region?
Well, they have no option but to, because they have a presence and they have an interest, and the United States continues to be one of the superpowers in the world. I mean, one of the superpowers because China has emerged, India has emerged, and Russia has reasserted itself. So it is a superpower still, and plays significantly important role around the world. And it has vital interests around our region as well. I'm sure they will remain focused. I'm sure they will remain searching for answers. I only hope that this focus and the search for answers or solutions or reevaluation will be done wisely and will be looked at from the facts on the ground, not the dreams that they have or the aspirations that they have.
Right. You've accused Pakistan of using religion as an instrument of foreign policy. You've also criticized America's role in the region.
Yes.
And we've seen Donald Trump's statements on Pakistan. He's berated it repeatedly. Do you think the equation is changing between Islamabad and Washington, and that might just help?
There are certain indications to this fact, in this direction. But we've seen such indications in the past as well, which didn't turn out true. Nobody wants Pakistan to be treated badly. Nobody wants Pakistan to not do well as a nation. India, Afghanistan, all of us want Pakistan to do well, to be a country that lives better with neighbors, in harmony, in a civilized relationship with neighbors, not through the use of militancy, radicalism, and terrorism as a tool, which unfortunately, yes, they did use against us and against others in this region. When we say stop, we don't mean that we want you, Pakistan, to be weak. We don't mean that we want you to be without your means. What we're telling Pakistan is use the right means to reach your objectives. And the right means are not extremism and terrorism as a tool of policy. The right means are as a civilized relationship, a modern relationship, a relationship that looks towards an open society and the promotion of interests like Europe is doing among its own nations. That's what we seek from Pakistan.
And what about China? How do you, are you disappointed they're dealing with Pakistan? They're reaching out to the Taliban, some say.
It's all right to talk to the Taliban. I propose that India should do the same. Talk to the Taliban. Everybody, the Americans are talking to the Taliban. The West can't say, well, we will talk to the Taliban. India shouldn't talk to the Taliban. It's a movement. There are people, and everybody is talking to them, as is the case all over the world. With China, Afghanistan has excellent relationship. They're a very good neighbor of Afghanistan. And during my government, this relationship expanded further. They have economic investments in Afghanistan. My desire as a citizen of this region is the best of relations between China and India. And it is indeed in cooperation between China and India that the two countries, the region, and by extension, the world would do better. So I'm one of those individuals who seeks immense cooperation between these two great nations.
Well, we all live in hope. Let's see how it goes.
Indeed.
Islamabad is also building a fence along the Durand line. This mm-hmm. is one of the recent developments. Mm-hmm. And you spoke about training the Taliban and sending them your way or training some militant elements. Mm-hmm. Islamabad is saying that it's the Afghan soil where these militants originate and then launch attacks both on Afghanistan and on Pakistan. How do you respond to that?
Well, it's some years that they're saying that. And when I was in office, I did not deny that. It is possible that a militant will come and use Afghanistan against Pakistan. But who created this environment? Who created these elements? Who created the thought? Who created the opportunity? And who prepared the ground for this? And fortunately, the Pakistani military establishment. They weakened themselves. And they weaken us, Afghanistan, so much that now possibly there is this or that element trying to use Afghanistan. So Afghanistan is a victim here of what Pakistan perpetrated against us. And by the law of unintended consequences against themselves, because they're now victims as well. Look at the bomb blasts in the shrines. Look at the extremism there against moderation, against music, against culture, against all the good aspects of life. So they must feel sorry that they've done that to themselves and to us.
And staying with the law of unintended consequences, one of them is many say Islamophobia in the West, the rising Islamophobia. Do you believe it's a consequence of...
It is a consequence, definitely. But especially speaking about the United States and some of its allies, they are very much to blame for the rise of militancy, religious militancy. They use religious militancy to the best extent they could against the former Soviet Union. So when they complain, I don't treat them as victims. When they complain, I treat them as perpetrators of a very bad consequence for the world. And I would hope that they would now see to it that that was wrong and do all they can with the rest of us to stop it. They're still hobnobbing with some of those elements. We know that, the Americans in the West, who created Daesh in the Middle East. It was the consequence of their action. The destruction of Iraq, the destruction of the military of Iraq, the creation of ethnic tensions and sectarian tensions in Iraq, they were the cause of it. And in Syria, look at that great civilization, the way they destroyed it, unfortunately. Therefore, I think it's the right time for common sense to prevail and for things to fall in the right place.
But they aren't, it seems, by the looks
of
it.
Yes. but we can only hope.
We can only hope, certainly. And coming back to the Durand line, it is being the fence is being built despite Afghanistan's protests. What are Kabul's options? What can it do at this point?
Well, fence is not going to stop people. Never. You cannot stop brothers from visiting one another, or families, or sisters, or children from the same family. So fence is not going to help, and fence is only going to add to suspicions and difficulty. So it's not a solution. The solution is, as far as Pakistan is concerned, towards us, neighbors, a civilized relationship and the recognition of realities. The reality is that Afghanistan is a neighbor. The reality is that India is a neighbor and that others are neighbors. And that the use of militancy or barriers is not going to promote any of Pakistan's interests, but rather will hurt them, as I've said before.
Right. Another reality is the huge number of Pashtuns living in Pakistan. Mm-hmm. And they're conducting a census for the first time in two mm-hmm. decades. Mm-hmm. And there is no clarity on what it would mean for the Pashtun population mm-hmm. in Pakistan. Where do you see this going? Do you believe they'll be given voting rights? They'll be...
Well, the Pashtun population in Pakistan is the consequence of the Durand Line drawn by the British, which Afghanistan never accepted. We consider that part of our territory, taken away by the British rule. We don't blame Pakistan for that. Pakistan was created almost more than 50 or 60 years after the Durand Line, more than 60 years. Durand Line was created or drawn in 1893. Pakistan was created in 1947. So we don't blame Pakistan, but Pakistan, by the fact of its creation and the way it was done by the British, became the inheritor of this line, which we have not accepted, which no Afghan will accept, which no Afghan government will accept. So yes, the Pashtuns are there in Pakistan in large numbers, and that's a fact that nobody can ignore.
Right. You've served as Afghanistan's president for more than a decade, mm-hmm. and the challenges remain. Mm-hmm. Are you thinking of a comeback?
No, I'm not thinking of a comeback. I've done my time. I was there for 13 years as a president, and I had my service to the country. I think that the newer generations of Afghans must emerge. We must be a bright, clear river flowing down towards the future. We should not become stagnant water, no.
That's a good thought. Are you writing a book?
Yes, I am.
When should we expect it? The Afghan ambassador's book, I believe, is coming out
yes.
very soon.
Yes, His book came out. Mine will be sometime from now.
Look forward to reading it.
Sure.
All the best, Hamid Karzai.
Thank you, ma'am. Much. Great Thank interview. You. Very, very good.
Next week on WION, World is One, Global Leadership Series, former Sri Lankan President Mahinda Rajapaksa talks exclusively to WION.
No Sri Lanka government can fail to recognize that cannot antagonize the two Asian giants, that is India and China. We have learned lessons now.